Namaste and a very warm welcome to all dear students. I welcome you all in the surgery class. Myself, JV and Dr. Hemant Vyas, Associate Professor and Head of Department of Surgery, Faculty of Homeopathic Science, Jyoti Vidyapeeth, Women's University, Jaipur. So today in our surgery class for BHMS third year, we are going to learn about an important topic, that is epistaxis. This chapter is included in our syllabus of ENT, and this question on epistaxis may be asked in the second paper of surgery. So generally question on epistaxis is a long question type, so we have to describe or we have to learn this in detail. So let's begin. So what is epistaxis? Epistaxis is any bleeding from our nose that may be visible from outside or from inside, that is from nasopharynx, is called as epistaxis. So the epistaxis may be bleeding. It may be from one or two drops, or it may be for several, that is 1 to 2 liters of blood may get lost from the nose, and in any case we call it as epistaxis. So let's see what are the types of epistaxis. So generally there are two types of epistaxis. One is anterior epistaxis, in which the blood comes out from the nostrils outside the nose. This is called as anterior epistaxis. Whereas one more type, that is posterior epistaxis, in which the bleeding occurs in vertebral plexus, and it is in the posterior side of the nose, in which the blood comes out in the oral cavity from the nasopharynx. The blood goes to oropharynx. It may be spitted out, or unknowingly many times the blood of the posterior part of the nose that may go inside our lungs or our stomach also. So posterior epistaxis is comparatively more dangerous than the anterior epistaxis, because in anterior epistaxis we can recognize that the blood is coming out from our nose, and likewise we can go for the management very quickly. But if the blood is coming out from posterior part of the nose, that is posterior epistaxis, it is many times it is unrecognized, and a lot of blood is lost. It is very difficult to control, and it is very difficult to decipher that the bleeding is coming from which part of the nose. Okay, now let's see what are the causes of epistaxis, because epistaxis itself is not a disease. It is a symptom of disease. So there are many diseases, or there are many conditions which can cause epistaxis. So let's see what are the causes. So causes are broadly divided into two categories, that is local causes as well as the systemic causes. So first we are going to study about local causes of epistaxis. So first is local, that is congenital. So in this the name of disease is multiple telangiectasia, and this is also known as Osler's disease. So what happens in Osler's disease, there is a formation of multiple capillary hemangioma inside our nasal cavity as well as on the tongue. So these two locations are having multiple capillary hemangiomas in Osler's disease, and they may readily bleed because of any touch or injury. So this is a congenital disorder leading to epistaxis. Then next is trauma. So any local trauma can induce epistaxis, because our nasal cavity, our septum of nose, is very rich in blood supply, and there is plexus that is called as Kesselbach plexus that can readily bleed if it gets any trauma or injury. So Post operative trauma is also common. Many times after the surgical procedure, if there is any extensive surgery of nose, then there is chance of hemorrhage, that may be spontaneous hemorrhage or induced hemorrhage. Reactionary hemorrhage, we can also say, that may be found after surgery. Then many times the bleeding comes out from the little's area. So in the septum of our nose, inside the septum of our nose, in the junction of posterior and anterior part, there is a plexus of arteries. This is called as little's area. So this little's area having the plexus, this plexus is called as Kesselbach plexus. So this Kesselbach plexus is very important, it is placed below the mucous membrane. So it is very superficial. So any injury, any blow to the septum of the nose can result into easily bleeding from the nose. So this is because of trauma. Then barotrauma can also cause bleeding from the nose, that is high altitude, or if the person is going inside the sea, that time because of the pressure, the patient may experience epistaxis. Then inflammatory causes are there. In some acute inflammations, which may have some specific causes that can lead to epistaxis. Let's see what are these specific inflammatory causes, which are local one. So first is nasal diphtheria. So what happens in nasal diphtheria? The diphtheric membrane is formed inside the nose, that is vestibules on the septum or terminate, a membrane is formed. Okay, and when we remove this membrane from the nose, that time the part may get bleeding inside the nose. Okay, so nasal diphtheria can result into epistaxis. Then there are some non-specific causes also, like acute vestibulitis. Then in acute vestibulitis, there is formation of boils inside the nose, and these boils can bleed and they can cause epistaxis. Then acute rhinitis and sinusitis can also result into epistaxis many times. Then adenoids. So the adenoids are the tonsils which are present in the roof of the nasopharynx. So behind the nose there is nasopharynx, and on the roof of nasopharynx a tonsillar tissue is present, that is called as adenoid. So if there is enlargement of adenoid or hypertrophy, then they can also bleed and cause posterior epistaxis. Then there are some chronic inflammations which can also lead to epistaxis. Let's see what are these chronic inflammations. They are chronic rhinitis and chronic sinusitis. Then a non-specific cause is there of chronic rhinitis, that is rhinitis sicca. So rhinitis sicca is dryness in the vestibule of the nose. So this part is called as vestibule, anterior part is called as vestibule of the nose. So if there is dryness, crusting in the nose, in the dusty and desert climate like in Rajasthan, if any person is coming from outside the Rajasthan, that person cannot get acclimatized to the changes going on in the, because the air is really very dry, the temperature is high, the environment is dusty all the time, the dust is blowing with the wind. So in some persons it may cause dryness of the mucous membrane of the anterior part of nose, and if it is chronically found in some person, that time we call it as rhinitis sicca. So what happens in this, that scabs are formed, and when the person removes those scabs from the nose, that time there is bleeding from the nose. because the scabs may be formed on the littles area, and when the person picks those scabs, then there is bleeding from the nose. Then one more prominent cause again is atrophic rhinitis. So in atrophic rhinitis, there is atrophy of all the parts inside the nose, and that may be because of the atrophy of the nasal septum, blood vessels all get sclerosed, and because of this there is bleeding in some cases from the nose. Then some specific causes are there, like rhinosporidiosis. In rhinosporidiosis, there is a fungus that is called as Rhinosporidium sebri. So what this where this fungus is mainly found, this fungus is mainly found in coastal areas, like in Konkan of Maharashtra, Goa, so then this side in Chennai, where there is very humid climate and there is animal feeder is spread all around, organic dust is there. So here the fungus can grow easily, and when this fungus comes in contact with nostril, it produces polypoidal growths, and these polypoidal growths are attached to nasal septum, and when we touch those polypoidal growths, then they bleed readily. So this is Rhinosporidium sebri, which cause rhinosporidiosis. Then some other diseases like tuberculosis, and then syphilis, leprosy, lupus, they can also produce granulomas, which can later turn into bleeding also. Then there are some neoplasms which can also cause bleeding from nostrils, and these are angiomas, then nasopharyngeal fibroadenomas, then some malignancies can be found in elderly patients. Then there are some miscellaneous causes of epistaxis. These are like foreign bodies from the nose. Foreign bodies insertion is generally seen in cases of children's. So in cases of foreign bodies, the bleeding comes out from one nostril in which there is insertion of foreign body. Then some nasal parasites can also which can produce mild epistaxis. Rhinolith is a condition in which there is calcification inside the nose, and these calcified bodies, when detached from their location, can lead to epistaxis. Then vicarious menstruation is also a cause in which there is epistaxis instead of menstruation. Okay, in menstruating women, there is epistaxis at the time when the menses should come. So the menses are suppressed and the bleeding comes out from nostrils. So this condition is generally rare, but yes, this is also a cause of epistaxis in some cases. Then let's see what are the systemic causes. So earlier, now we have seen all local causes. Now what are the systemic causes of epistaxis? Systemic causes include hypertension, which is the very important cause of epistaxis, generally found in elderly patients. So in elderly patients, there is epistaxis from posterior side of the nose in the Woodruff's plexus. Okay, in posterior side of the nose, there in anterior there is Kesselbach plexus in the littles area, whereas in posterior side there is Woodruff plexus. So this Woodruff plexus can bleed because of atherosclerotic vessels, and because of hypertension they can bleed, and this bleeding is very crucial to control, but it is very difficult also to control, and a lot of blood can be shed in this condition. Then there are some bleeding disorders like leukemia, hemophilia, purpura, agranulocytosis and Hodgkin's disease, which can also result into epistaxis. Then increased pressure in superior vena cava. Superior vena cava pressure can also cause bleeding from nostrils. Environmental factors like high altitude, or if the person is going below the sea level, in the depth of sea, in that there is very large pressure, or if the person is going in the atmosphere, in the sky, in very high altitudes, then there is also lack of oxygen, and that in high altitude there is pressure from environment which can produce nosebleed or epistaxis. Then some infections like viral infections, enteric fever, rheumatic fevers, and infective endocarditis can also produce epistaxis. Then there are some diseases like chronic renal failure, uremia, toxemia, that may lead to epistaxis. Then there are some causes which are unknown, that are categorized under idiopathic. When there is no obvious cause of nosebleed, that time we call it as idiopathic epistaxis. So common site of epistaxis are in nasal septum, Little's area, and above the middle turbinate. Then in Woodruff's plexus, as we have discussed, in the nasopharynx there is Woodruff's plexus. Then what are the clinical features? There is we have to evaluate the quantity which is lost. Then anterior, either the bleeding may be anterior or posterior. Then there is hemoptysis or hematemesis can be found if the blood is diluted or engulfed. Then anxiety can be seen in the patient, and patient may go in shock if the bleeding is massive. In that case, patient may go in shock. What investigations we have to do? We have to check blood pressure of the patient, hemogram, a test for coagulation, that is BT and CT, clotting time and bleeding time. Bleeding time has to be carried out. Radiograph has to be done to evaluate the area. CT scan can be done. Endoscopy and bioscopy can be, biopsy can be required to evaluate the or to find out the exact cause of the disease. Then management of epistaxis. For the first stage, the patient should be made bent forward, and the nose should be pinched for a particular time so that the Little's area from where the bleeding occurs can be pressed, and after some time the bleeding may get stopped. But if the bleeding is coming from posterior side of the nose, then we have to go for packing of the nose, in which we go for anterior packing, in which the ribbon gauze which is impregnated with lubricant like Vaseline or liquid paraffin, that has to be inserted inside the nose, and the nose is completely packed, and after packing the bleeding may stop after some time. Or we can go for posterior packing, in which we have to introduce the Foley's catheter inside the nose, and the Foley's catheter will come out from the mouth. Now we will inject the fluid, and when the balloon is inflated, then we pull back the catheter outside. As the balloon is inflated, it will block the site of posterior bleeding. Okay, so this can be very helpful for stopping the posterior epistaxis. So and if even after these measures, if the bleeding is not stopping, then we have to go for surgical ligature of the maxillary artery or ethmoidal arteries. So that's it from the today's presentation. If hope you like this presentation. Thank you very much.